what were some of the issues coming in that might have presented, you know, differences starting out? Yeah. So what are some of the theological reasons that gave rise to the need for a Marburg colloquy? Was it more than just the Lord's Supper, or was that even at the very beginning kind of the real sticking point?
If you look at Luther, if you compare Lutheran theology or Luther's theology to Zwingli's theology, there are definitely differences in emphases. Justification by grace through faith, for example, which is absolutely central to Luther and will become, you know, central to Calvin as well, is somewhat conspicuous by its absence from Zwingli. My doctoral supervisor, Peter Stevens, did his work on Bucer and Zwingli. And I remember in one of my seminar discussions with him when I was starting my PhD, and him highlighting the comparative lack of discussions of justification in Zwingli that surprised me. Now, of course, the lack of emphasis doesn't necessarily mean fundamental disagreement in content. Though it has to be said, when you look at Zwingli's allusions to justification, he's perhaps more kind of Augustinian / transformative than Luther would have been. But that's not a major bone of contention between them as far as I can see. Mm-hmm. If we're looking for an emphasis in Zwingli then that we don't find in Luther, I think Zwingli's emphasis on providence is a powerful one, and arising in some ways out of very distinct pastoral situation, where 1519 to 1520, the plague comes to Zurich, and 25% of the inhabitants of Zurich are wiped out by plague. And this drives Zwingli to reflect upon the sovereignty of God and upon the nature of God's providence in a way that was never quite the case for Luther. So with Zwingli, we have, you know, Luther, we have justification. With Zwingli, we perhaps have sovereignty. Mm-hmm. But having said that, those weren't major points of tension between them. The big one is the Lord's Supper, and very specifically, whether the whole Christ, divine and human, is present, to use the terminology of later Lutheranism, in, with, and under the elements of bread and wine. Yeah. In medieval theology, as you guys know, the thinking was that at the moment of consecration, the substance of the bread and wine changed into the substance of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not that there was anemic flesh in the bread and just blood in the wine, the whole Christ became the substance of both elements. So all that was left was an appearance of bread and wine, not any real bread
and wine. The accident, yeah.
Yeah. Luther, pretty early on in his career, gets rid of that idea and has Christ present, the whole Christ, divine and human, present in the bread and the wine. And that will become the big bone of contention with the Zwinglians. Mm-hmm. The way that becomes so is a somewhat convoluted story, but really goes to the heart of why Marburg becomes such a big deal and divides Lutheran and Reformed. In fact, Jeff very kindly did a plug for the book I did with my good pal Bob Kolb. And when the book came out, around about the time the book came out, I remember having dinner with Bob. I think we were down at Baylor University together, speaking at a conference, and we were having dinner or lunch together. And he made the comment that he expected to be beaten up in some conservative Lutheran quarters, metaphorically speaking, for even writing a book like that with a Reformed person. And yeah, I'm sitting there.
Well, certainly in the Wisconsin evangelical.
Oh, Lutherans. Yeah. Yeah. And on the conservative wing of the Missouri Synod. Whereas as a Reformed guy, I never crossed my mind that any Reformed person they might say to me, this is a pointless exercise perhaps, but I didn't think that anyone would see it as an exercise involving a fundamental compromise of the gospel.
Right, yeah.
So it's really
a crypto-Lutheran.
Yeah, and there's a long way between the Luther of 1519, 1520 and the Luther of 1529 that explains exactly why the stakes get so high in 1529.